Welcome to the Veritas Forum, engaging university students and faculty in discussions about life's hardest questions and the relevance of Jesus Christ to all of life.
Let's go ahead and begin. And I'd like to ask both professors, starting with David, can you briefly describe your worldview and how you came to hold the beliefs that you currently hold?
Sure. Well, as Elizabeth has already hinted, I'm kind of a strange combination in contemporary America. I am a pointy-headed Ivy League professor, and I'm also a theologically orthodox Christian, by which I mean that I believe that all of us have rebelled against God and that our only hope of reconciliation with God is through the sacrifice on the cross of Jesus Christ. So my worldview is a worldview that is shaped by both of these perspectives and by the belief that Christianity explains many of the complexities of our world better than any other perspective on offer.
Thank you. And Eugene, what about you? What's your worldview and how did you come to hold it?
My worldview is sort of best as maybe captured as muddling through. I don't have much of a coherent worldview. I'm supposed by modern standards I'm a libertarian. To non-libertarians, to hardcore libertarians, I'm, I guess, what they call a squish. You know, it's really hard to tell. One way of thinking about it, is, at least for those of you who are Christians in the audience, is to imagine that a Mormon comes to you and says, well, you know, you should become a Mormon because here are these books and they're the truth. And we know this because angels visited Joseph Smith some 170, 180, I suppose, years ago. Or let's say a Muslim comes to your door. I don't suppose they do much coming to doors, but imagine they would. Or in any event, they would come to your metaphorical door. They would love converts because they believe that their view is right and says the same thing about their book. Suppose you'd say, well, that's kind of odd. These are some rather interesting factual assertions you're making about angels coming and bringing things. I'd like to see some proof. Before I believe in something, especially before I orient my life around this, I need to see some pretty serious evidence. Well, that was me, but that's also me with regard to Christianity, or for that matter, Judaism, which I suppose is the religion of my forebears, although not my family, at least two generations back. So I find maybe my life would be better if I believed. Maybe all of society would be better if everybody believed in some particular religion, although then the interesting question is which one. I just can't, because it doesn't seem to me to be sufficiently demonstrated. So what do? Well, I muddle through, I suppose. I think about what seems just to me, always recognizing that I may be completely wrong. Thinking about what seems just to other people that I know, and especially ones I respect, recognizing they may be completely wrong. Think about what seems to make sense from perspective of, say, equality. Well, if one thing is right, then shouldn't this other thing be right too, given that they don't seem to be that different? Recognizing, of course, our judgments about equality could be wrong too. As a libertarian, I believe in liberty, but it's not liberty to do absolutely everything. It's liberty to do things that don't violate other people's rights, by and large. Well, what are other people's rights? Itself a very difficult question. I can't claim that I know the answer. I do feel I know that there are some things I can't say. I can't say, well, this is right because it's written in some book, because then I have to explain why that book is something I should believe, and I don't have much evidence for that. But that's what I try to do, and I'll tell you, my sense is that many people I know, including ones who are quite religious, actually do much the same thing. And I think we see that a little bit if you look at the sheer diversity of views on utterly fundamental moral issues among people who would describe their theological commitments very much the same as yours, among people who read the Bible, the same Bible that you read. And likewise within Judaism, likewise I imagine within Islam and the like. I think they're all kind of muddling through too. And some of them may say, nope, I'm going to follow the words in this book. But then the question is, what about multiple interpretations? Well, they try to figure it out. Or, more likely, I'm going to follow the tradition as set forth by my leaders. That may be less ambiguous to them, though may still be choices that the leaders have to make. But I think most people do. Sort of they say, it's like I've Catholics fault cafeteria Catholicism. I think most of us, even religious people, are kind of cafeteria believers in various ideologies because they muddle through much the same way, I think, in many ways, as I do, sort of trying to test the things that they're being offered against the judgment of their own intuitions and of people that they trust and respect. So not very satisfying. It's not very satisfying to me. I don't see why it should be satisfying to you. But that's sort of the best I got.
So with the backdrop now of the worldviews that each of David and Eugene hold, let's move into the meat of tonight's topic and what is justice. And I guess let's start, David, with the question, are you optimistic about the future of justice in our society?
So if the specific question were, is our society more just now than it was 100 years ago, say, or 120 years ago, I would say yes. I would say on a lot of dimensions, the legal system and the culture we know is more just than it was 100 years ago. We don't have the same kind of racism at the same, manifesting itself in the same ways, for instance, that we had in 120 years ago. But it seems to me that to go from that perspective, from that intuition that we have made some progress in some respects to a conclusion that we are capable of creating a fully just society, and Eugene may even agree with me on this given your muddling through perspective, but to reach the conclusion that because of the progress that we've seen in some areas, we are capable as human beings of creating a legal code that will give us a fully just society is a huge mistake. And it's a mistake that is, in my view, becoming increasingly common, at least among public intellectuals. There's a Harvard linguist probably many of you have at least heard of named Steven Pinker, who wrote a book called The Better Angels of Our Nature, fascinating book that argues that we're living in the least violent time in human history. As violent as it seems, if you compare our time to other times, we're much less violent than human beings were in the past. He also suggests, because of things like the abolition of slavery and the civil rights movement, the improvement of women's rights, the gay rights movement, even now an animal rights movement, that we are moving towards justice and that we're capable of achieving a fully just society. I think that that is a huge, huge mistake. Historically, when we've been optimistic about our capacity for justice, bad things have tended to happen. 100 years ago, there was a huge optimism about America and America becoming a promised land in terms of justice. One of the things that led to was the eugenics movement. Sterilizing people who were seen as unfit to reproduce. So the idea that we're moving towards true justice, I think, is a huge mistake. And when someone tells you that we live in a fully just society now, or an almost fully just society, or someone tells me that, as I have been told that recently in response to this little book of mine that will be coming out in the fall, my reaction is that in a society where if you are a black man who did not graduate from college, there's a 33% chance you'll spend time in jail. If you're a black man who did not graduate from high school, there's a 60% chance that you will spend some time in jail. We do not have a fully just society, and I don't believe that we're capable of producing that. And humility about our capacity for justice, I think, is absolutely essential. I'm really interested to hear what Eugene says about this, because I think this is consistent with muddling through.
Oh, I don't have any disagreement about the bottom line by any means. I will say, I have a slightly different explanation of it, although maybe not even. I think part of the problem is we can't even have confidence that we know what justice is, and certainly we have seen how very good people whom we think to be very good in very many ways in the past, have believed things we now consider to be unjust. Surely, if we have any humility at all, we should recognize that some things that we firmly believe are all about justice might be seen as unjust 50 or 100 or 200 years from now. maybe unjustly so. Maybe we were right and they were wrong. But absent a clear yardstick, which, as I mentioned, I don't think even religion offers, given the multiple definitions of justice that exist within any particular large religious community, the multiple rival and inconsistent definitions of justice, I can't even imagine how society that in which everybody behaves up to the society's standard of justice is going to be just. But on top of that, why should we believe that in a society everybody will behave up to society's standard of justice? There are places where it's more likely than there were, and where it's less likely, where it happens more and less often. It's for a variety of reasons. But there's certainly no reason to think that under any reasonable moral code, other than, hey, anybody can do whatever they please, that you'd have 100% compliance. I'm surprised. The one thing that surprises me, David, about what you're saying is that anybody tells you that we are living in a just or almost just or very nearly just society. I do think it's plausible to think that as time goes on, maybe things will become more just, in part because we have seen such a pattern, generally speaking, in the broad scheme over the last, say, 500 years. There might be some economic reasons why we might think that as scarcity declines in particular ways, at least certain threats to justice decrease. There are technological reasons. For example, women's rights is probably very closely linked to changes in reproductive technology. So it's nice to pursue justice. I am optimistic that we can achieve more justice if we try hard enough, but certainly not perfect or anything close to it. I have no reason to think that at all.
Are we allowed to,
yeah,
to
double? No,
I think we're encouraged.
So if you were asked the question, is American society more just today than it was in 1890, do you feel like you can answer that question?
I think it would depend on what I thought about abortion. Am speaking of muddling through. I'm sort of generally pro-abortion rights, but I'm kind of tentatively that. I mean, I don't know. Maybe I'm completely wrong. Maybe this is one of those things that 100 years from now, people will just think, my God, how could people believe this? Likewise, maybe 100 years from now, my God, how could people eat meat? I mean, they're mammals. They're almost the same as us. So it's possible. You know, I don't know. I think there are some things I'm more confident about, some things less. This is one of the things I'm less confident about. If you really think that abortion is murder, then it's hard to see how society, which has several million murders, is better even than a society which harshly discriminated against tens of millions of people and lynched some number, fortunately, compared to the number of abortions, a small number. But you know, if you really think that abortion is murder, it's hard to see our society as just compared to virtually any other society out there. On the other hand, if you set that aside, I think under other metrics, it probably is much more just. But that just shows how hard it is to even say whether we achieve perfect justice. I mean, I suppose there's some people who are completely positive they know the right answer about abortion on both sides, and otherwise decent people. So again, I can't even tell how to know which one is right and which one's wrong. I'm not. I think that actually quite a few people aren't. And with something like that, how can you know when you can't even answer a basic question like that? How can you hope that we'll ever achieve close to perfect justice?
Well, that's a great transition, I think, into the question of, you know, how does your worldview, and this is for you, Eugene, provide a foundation for true justice? How do we know what that is? And I guess, and then we'll ask David the same question.
I don't know. I mean, I think that the best we can do is try to think about what is just and what is not. I do think that there are evolved mechanisms within our psychology that find certain things to trigger sort of a sense of injustice. I think there's some experiments that indicate this. I think from an early age, kids show certain kinds of attitudes towards justice, although it often has to do with justice as to whether they're getting what they feel they deserve. But we are wired for empathy. I think there's no doubt about that. We're wired for empathy. We're wired for love. Well, probably for hatred and certainly for anger. But I do think that there are mechanisms within our minds that allow us to think about these things. And that if you reflect sometime, I like to think that one thing that happened with regard to slavery is that if you think long enough about not even equality, but just liberty, at some point you sort of have to start reflecting and saying, how can I be saying liberty for me and fighting a war, a revolutionary war of liberty for me, and not be thinking about that with regard to others who seem just as human as I am. So I think that there are, that between empathy, between a certain degree of moral sense that we have innate in us, between that and judgments about equality, and I don't think reason alone is going to get you very far on these things, but I do think that it can help guide us to certain decisions. I think we can improve things, and I think a lot of the improvement that we have seen has stemmed from that. But yeah, I can't claim this is at all a firm foundation for assured progress towards justice. I just don't see anything much more that has much of a firm foundation.
You don't even have to ask a question at this point. I agree with Eugene completely. Although I will say this, I do agree.
You mean do you agree with me? You disagree with me completely, or you agree with me not completely?
You tell me which it is when I get finished talking.
Sounds good.
So one thing that I would say is all of the things that you, or several of the things that Eugene is talking about, which I think are really interesting. And accurate, such as our innate capacity for empathy, and also a tendency to misbehave that we have that wrestles with that empathy for supremacy within us. One of the things that really strikes me about these findings, which are becoming increasingly prominent in psychology, is they seem to me to confirm, I'll call a Christian, but we could say Judeo-Christian, a Judeo-Christian understanding of our nature. And I think this understanding of our nature is essential as a foundation for justice. So what is the Judeo-Christian understanding of our nature? The understanding is that each of us is made in the image of God, and we need to recognize that God loves each of us equally. Sounds a lot like empathy. We're each made in the image of God, and this is where the idea of loving one's neighbor comes from. It spins out of that. But at the same time, we're also sinful. We also have an innate tendency to misbehave. That is the standard Judeo-Christian understanding of what humans are like, and it seems to me that a lot of the psychological findings that people sometimes think of as completely separate from Christianity really are confirming a Christian understanding of the world. And I think that an understanding of justice needs to start with this as a foundation. So when you talk about how we can think about justice, I want to say more than just we're muddling through and we have a certain amount of empathy. I want to say that our justice should start with the principle that each of us is made in the image of God, and that our legal system and our culture should reflect that. But it also should recognize the fact that we have a tendency to misbehave, or what Christians would say, would call a sinfulness about us. And the legal system needs to balance those two elements of human behavior. The philosopher Thomas Hobbes famously said that without law and without a government, which he called Leviathan, life would be nasty, brutish, and short. And I think there is something to that. The problem is, if we just assume that ordinary people are sinful and we need to restrain them through law, there's a tendency to forget that lawmakers and law enforcers also are sinful. And that if we give them too much authority, they're likely to misbehave. And it seems to me that from this, we get a foundation for what a legal system should look like. And it has two somewhat contradictory, or seemingly contradictory, but both important qualities, it seems to me. We have an obligation to pursue justice and to seek the well-being of others on the one hand, but we also need to be realistic about the capacity of justice, and that a just legal system, it will inevitably be a humble legal system. One of the ironies of human nature, it seems to me, is that less is more with law. The less we try to do very frequently with law, the better and more effective the law will be. When we try to do too much with law, often the results are counterproductive. I think that was one of the problems with the culture, with Christians in the culture wars over the last generation. We've tried to do too much with law, in my view. The one other thing I'll say is, just to continue a little bit of the distinction between my perspective and Eugene's, Christianity does provide a foundation for justice, and it does provide an obligation to pursue justice. You might not agree with Christianity, you might not believe it, but if you accept it, if you are persuaded that Christianity tells us how we can be reconciled with God, it creates an obligation to pursue justice, and it also provides a way to think about justice. And I believe that there are disagreement about lots of elements, but I think there is more agreement than disagreement as to what Christianity says about justice. A muddling through kind of view does not give you any foundation for justice. So if Eugene is making all the decisions, I'm kind of comfortable because Eugene is really, really smart. You probably haven't noticed this yet, but he is very smart, and he has really good judgment. And so if Eugene were setting up our legal system, I'd be comfortable with it. I read his blog, and I go, you know, you tell him, Eugene, when I read his blog. But when other people who have other views, who are also muddling through, are in control, bad things often happen. And the point here, the important point, I think, is if you don't have an objective foundation, objective basis for justice, you don't have any sure way of defining what justice is. And muddling through can mean very different things to different people.
I think that's a great transition to
there's maybe a little more to explore here.
Oh, absolutely.
I think there are a couple of things in what you're saying there. And the first, which I think I very much agree, is that there is a foundation for justice, which is a sense of roughly, you might say, equality, at least equality of rights. Not necessarily equality of results, but equality of rights in the sense that I should not expect that the world owes me better treatment than any other random person out there. Now, you might say it's because we are all equally made in God's image, or you might say because we're all equally entitled to rights, or because you might say if we look at it from behind the veil of ignorance, I suppose that's sort of a Rawlsian perspective, we ought to recognize that we ought to be treated equally, although I suppose the veil of ignorance assumes the conclusion that we should be treated equally.
Oh, absolutely. I would think you would have some problems with the veil of ignorance.
I have some problems with everything. So you could say that the trouble is it actually doesn't take you very far. Whether you say that we're made in God's image or that we should all be treated equally because there's no real basis for distinction, whether you say we're all sinful or whether you say, well, all of us have within us the psychological constructs that lead us to kill and rape and rob and such, not perhaps each individual one of us, but certainly lead us as a species, there's no doubt that that is so, whichever it is that you choose, you have a sense that there ought to be some mechanism of trying to accomplish justice despite these weaknesses, but it doesn't get you much by way of specifics. Now, the second thing is you might say, well, okay, Christianity at least, which goes beyond just those two insights, does give you some specifics. But here I have two concerns. I'd like to see what David has to say about them. So one is, just returning to the thing that I started with, I suppose if one did say, yes, one needs to accept the Bible as a basis for justice, or the teachings of a particular church as the basis for justice, then indeed it's true, one will be more likely to seek justice according to that particular framework. What it doesn't tell us, though, is why we should think that this framework, as opposed to all the other rival frameworks, whether religious or otherwise, is the right one. So again, it sounds like to assume the conclusion, say, well, Christianity provides for justice. And I'm not saying this is what you're saying, David, but some do say, because it allows people to follow God's will. How do we know God's will? Well, it's expressed in the Bible. Well, that yes, Christianity leads people to behave in ways that are consistent with Christianity, but that doesn't tell us that much. The second problem, though, as I see it, is actually I'm not sure just how much Christianity really gives it by way of answers to specific questions, just looking at the historical record. Christians have famously given completely different answers to questions such as slavery, questions such as abortion, questions such as religious freedom, questions such as democracy, the free market, I'm just beginning. We can come up with a vast list of other things. Blasphemy. And this is famous. Anybody who reads history sees just how radical the differences among Christians have been. And they're all people who I think were thinking hard about some of these issues that you mentioned. So just as an empirical matter, I'm not sure that Christianity will give much of a specific framework for answering questions. So I'm wondering what your thought on that is.
There's a lot of stuff in there.
There is.
So I'm just gonna take on some
sure,
of it. But those are great points and really interesting ones. One is on the nature of justice. You talked about equality and the idea that we can probably agree that equality has to be at the core of justice. In my view, what justice is, and I suspect you may agree with me, is it's inevitably one way to there are several different ways I think we can think about justice. I think if I were asked to define justice very simply, I would start by saying justice is right relationships among people, which gets us towards the equality. But another way to look at justice, it seems to me, is at the heart of justice is a trade-off between equality and liberty, as I see it. And I think that's what Rawls is getting at, that's what other people are getting at, that it's important to promote equality within a culture, but often when you promote equality, you necessarily are limiting the liberty of people. And Eugene is a constitutional law scholar, so this will sound kind of funny to him, I think.
No, not at all.
Because, well, the current Supreme Court is kind of collapsing those things together. It's using liberty to create equality. But I think there's a trade-off between liberty and equality that lies at the heart of justice, and I think you can see that in a Christian perspective on justice. The second thing I'll say is I think it's really important when we talk about issues where justice seems to have increased over time, particularly in the West, things like slavery, where we moved from one place to another, to acknowledge the role that Christianity has played in that. And this is not really a critique of Eugene in any way, but frequently when people talk about how just we are now, they act as if Christianity played no role in the civil rights movement, for instance. And that's just not accurate. Christians have some failings to explain historically, but many of the things that we see as justice movements were anchored in Christianity and were anchored in Christian principles. Another issue Eugene raises is why should you accept one of these perspectives rather than another? Why should you accept Christianity, particularly when there are different Christian views on things? And I think that's a great question. I think that once you accept Christianity, if you accept Christianity, it enables you to think about these issues. And although there's been lots of divergence on things, I think on a lot of core issues, there's not a lot of divergence. But there still is the question, you know, are we putting the cart ahead of the horse? I mean, why should you accept Christianity? And I think the answer to that has to be that you're persuaded that Jesus rose from the dead, that he was resurrected, and that our reconciliation with God is only through that resurrection and his sacrifice on behalf of our sins. And so then you have to talk about things, and maybe this is another dialogue between Eugene and me for another time, such as, is there any evidence for the resurrection? How is the evidence good or is it bad? There's not a slam dunk there's not slam dunk evidence. We don't have a photograph of Jesus being resurrected, at least that I've seen. But people often, if you have one, show it to me, although I'll be a little skeptical, I think. But people often jump from that to a conclusion that there's no good evidence of the resurrection, and it's just this leap of faith. There's actually a lot of what I consider to be very good evidence of the resurrection. I'll just give two examples. One is the way the early church acted after Jesus' death. Even though they were persecuted, and the Bible talks particularly about the change in the Apostle Peter after Jesus' death, the early church was persecuted for decades. It would have been really convenient to disavow the resurrection. It would have been the safe thing to do, and they didn't do that. They seemed to believe deeply that Jesus had been resurrected from the dead. Second piece of evidence, the fact that the primary testimony of the resurrection came from women. In first century Rome, the testimony of women was not admissible in a legal court. And so the fact that the Bible tells us that it was women who saw that Jesus was not in the grave, in my view, it's not slam dunk, but when you start putting these things together, there is a very plausible case that Jesus was who he says he was and that he was resurrected from the dead. And as a Christian, I'm not just taking a leap of faith. What I've seen in my muddling through persuades me that this is the most compelling explanation of the world. And you know, a third of the world agrees with me on that. Two-thirds of the world doesn't agree with me on that. And hopefully the two-thirds of the world, the rest will come around. the final thing that I'll say is, Eugene gave a number of examples of things that Christians have disagreed with and things that Christians have taken positions that now look benighted to us as well. And you didn't put it in those terms.
For my purposes, it was enough that there was disagreement.
Okay. So what I was going to say about that is, I've already said one thing, which is I think on many of the core issues there is not serious disagreement. I do think that there is lots of disagreement on various issues. I think it's also important to look at the trajectory of Christianity. So on an issue like slavery and civil rights, in the 19th century, there were Christians on both sides of that issue. Some of the strongest arguments against or in favor of slavery were made by people who identified themselves as Christians. So this is both disagreement, which is what Eugene is talking about, but it's also it's a position we rightly find unfathomable today. What I would say about that is another of the key selling points of Christianity is it is self-correcting. I don't believe you can read the Bible, particularly read the Bible now, and conclude that slavery, particularly the American style of slavery, is compatible with the Bible. Christianity, a lot of Christians have a lot to answer for in the 19th century, and I think even after the 19th century, but it's also the case that Christianity was at the heart of changing our culture on those issues as well. And it seems to me on the issues where there's not just disagreement, but views that look really problematic today, Christianity is self-correcting. On almost all of those issues, if you asked if that's consistent with what Christ died for and what he taught, you would conclude, no, it's not. And that view is going, the benighted view is going to lose out over time. So, to slightly qualify something I said earlier about my pessimism about justice, I think that's what Martin Luther King had in mind when he said, the arc of history is long, but it bends towards justice. I don't think it bends quickly towards justice, but I think in some ways it does.
Yeah, to make it a little, to quantify it a bit, and I should say I have
there's no doubt that much of abolitionism in America was Christian abolitionism, though it's a little bit overdetermined in part because much of everybody in America back then were Christian.
That's right.
So it's hard to tell exactly what is owed to Christianity. But I will say that for 90% of the history of the Christian church, slavery was either tolerated or by some actually viewed as compatible with Christianity, and the most Catholic majesty of the King of Spain was a very major component of the slave trade, as were Protestants and as was pretty much everybody else, with probably a few exceptions here and there. So I'm delighted that the world in general seems to have largely seen the light on the question of slavery, and I don't want to fault Christianity as such for it, but it does seem to me that if we look to see that things are improving, if we ask, you know, if it did take 1,800 plus years, in part perhaps because Christianity does in some measure, although in a very complicated measure, adopt an Old Testament which spoke quite neutrally about slavery, except slavery of Jews, well, as our slavery, that's bad, it's the first day of Passover. Well, that was condemned, but slavery in general, it was out there. I just wonder to what extent one can sort of praise Christianity. I don't want to damn Christianity for this. I don't want to fault Christianity for this. But praise Christianity for its self-correction when it's self-correction for maybe 5 to 10% of the history of the Christian church.
Right. It's a fair and good question. And I would just say a couple of things about that. First is just to acknowledge that it's more complicated than I wish it were. But it is the case that for much of history, slavery, which looked very different from American slavery, the slaves were mostly people who were overwhelmed by debt. So a lot of slavery was debt-related, and a lot of slavery was war-related, was war captives. It was the primary economic engine of the Roman Empire in much of the ancient world. So it was in the water in the ancient world. That doesn't answer your question, but that just... It's just putting it in a context that slavery was what made the economy go back then. That's the first thing I would say. The second thing I would say is the trajectory of the Bible very clearly destabilizes slavery. So I think if we look at the Old Testament, it looks somewhat neutral, although there are some complicating things for those who would advocate slavery in the Old Testament. In the New Testament, we have the Apostle Paul saying there's no slave or free in Christ. There's no male or female in Christ. There are descriptions. There's a small book of the Bible that is a letter involving a slave that is written in a way that, first of all, makes clear the slave should be treated as an equal, and second of all, at least through our modern eyes, makes it clear that slavery is not justifiable, that it's not a sustainable relationship. So what I would say, and I'm really agreeing with with Eugene's point, is that the trajectory of the Bible is necessarily inconsistent with slavery. But I think it's a fair enough point that that didn't happen 2,000 years ago. That happened much, much more recent. And I mean, it's important to keep in mind that America is different from the rest of the world in this respect even now. In much of the world, slavery is still a real presence. We're unusual in that in most respects, slavery is gone. I mean, there are some things that look like slavery, such as sex trafficking, even in America. But elsewhere in the world, there still is a fair amount of slavery.
So I think we're unfortunately nearing the end of our discussion here. But what I would love to hear, starting with Eugene, you know, before we end the discussion and open it up to questions from the audience, is, you know, what would look like for you to have people here tonight be part of your vision for justice?
I don't know. It's hard to tell. Like, it's very easy for me to say, well, it's for you to agree with my vision of justice. I can give you a list of items, specific issues that I believe in. And other talks that will often involve me making an argument for one particular vision of justice, whether it has to do with organ markets or
gun rights or free speech or whatever else. But that's not what you're really after. So the question, I suppose, is one of method. Well, I think part of it is, I do think that, I think what we would have to agree on is, you can't really seek justice unless you really think hard about it. It's not sufficient. People have thought hard about justice and have come to very, very bad results indeed. But I do think it's necessary to just be constantly thinking, look, you know, here's the way we do things. There's something, some basis for respecting the way we do things because we've done them for a long time. That Burke, I think, had very good perspectives on this. But Burke, though he is the patron saint of modern conservatism, was far from a hidebound conservative. We also have to change the way we do things. But when we think hard about, you know, is it fair what we're doing to people? So I think complacency in many respects is the enemy of justice, although there are other enemies as well. So I don't want to suggest that mere kind of active engagement is going to be enough. I think the other thing which I have to say, again, you know, if you really are persuaded by the evidence of Jesus' resurrection, well, then sure enough, that's a pretty big deal. Any power that is capable of doing that and that seems to have the one, they also have to be persuaded that the Bible is authentically represents Jesus' words, was probably something we should care about. Not certainly. You could certainly imagine a world that was created by malevolent powers or by powers that are actually indifferent to us or that try to like to play tricks on us, but at least it's a pretty powerful argument. I do think that one needs to, just because of Veritas, one needs to think about that. One needs to think, what are the standards of evidence that we accept when people claim all sorts of things, whether it's about Mormonism or about Islam or about supernatural things, about aliens, about Elvis Presley, about werewolves, about ghosts. And by and large, we're pretty skeptical. There is this common saying, which I think is sometimes oversaid, but I think is correct, extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. And it generally takes more than just, well, some people have said things, especially some people have said things many hundreds of years ago or thousands of years ago, for us to believe things. Now, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe there is such powerful evidence that leads you to believe that. And if it does lead you to believe that, then you have to go where your beliefs lead you. But I do think that we ought to be thinking, just for the sake of truth, that whatever it is that we're going to do, hard to make it work unless it's founded on some sensible understanding of our desire to goal. To seek truth, we need to think hard about it. And sometimes it leads, again, into difficult positions. I have no doubt that my position is a difficult one, but I do think that's one thing people need to do.
Thanks. What about you, David? What would it look like for people here tonight to play a part in your vision for what justice is?
So I'll say a couple things about that. One is, I agree with Eugene's point about the importance of thinking hard about justice. And one of the things that's really cool about this conversation that if y'all aren't law students, you won't realize is we don't spend a lot of time talking about justice in law school. In fact, that's why I think that's why this is not being held in the law school. It's being held in the business school is why we're here, because don't tell anybody we're talking about justice. I think you do have to think hard about justice, and I'll say a couple more things about that. One is, in answer to the question, what would it look like? Well, if you were to embrace the same Christian vision of justice, or the same kind of Christian vision of justice that I've embraced, well, it will look like very different things. So, for some people, it might be getting actively involved in efforts to eliminate the sex trafficking trade. There's an organization probably some of y'all are familiar with called International Justice Mission that's doing that sort of thing, and involved with using existing laws to try to free people from various forms of oppression around the world. Now, that's something that looks immediately recognizable as participating in justice. That's something that some of us might feel a desire and a call to do. For other people, I think it means other things. So it might mean trying to ensure better free speech in this country and full enforcement of the constitutional right of free speech, which is what Eugene's an expert in. For me, it might mean trying to do whatever little things I can do to improve our bankruptcy system. so that people who need a fresh start have a fresh start, and that our bankruptcy system is consistent with a vision of justice. So it can mean all sorts of different things for different people. The other thing that I'd say, just to sort of pitch my Christian perspective on this one more time, is one of the really cool things about the Christian perspective on justice is if you believe the things that I've been talking about, you will also believe that our lives are eternal and that we are part of an eternal reformation process, that the world has been corrupted by our sinfulness, that God will ultimately, we don't know when, and we know that we're not capable of achieving justice, but God is. Being a Christian means participating in that project, and that's a project not just for now, but it's a project for all eternity. And I believe that one of the things that means is that the contributions, however small, however fragile, however imperfect they may be, that we make to justice today may have eternal significance.
Thank you very much. With that, I think we'd like to open up tonight's discussion to questions that any of you may have for Eugene or David. You are welcome to text or email your questions to us using the contact information on the screen behind me. You are also welcome to come up to one of the two mics that we have on either side of the auditorium. So please keep your questions brief so we can get through as many as possible.
So we can talk at great length.
All right, so we have our first question for both of our partners in dialogue tonight, which is, have you ever embraced a different worldview? And if so, how did your worldview evolve to where you are now?
Great question. Should I start?
Yeah.
I think I very briefly embraced the worldview of Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance, which probably some of you have heard of. This was when I was in college. For most of my life until I got to college, I would have probably characterized myself, if I were articulate enough to do it, in the way that Eugene is using the phrases that he's used, that I kind of muddled through. So the first set of beliefs that I would say I deeply held and continue to hold are Christian beliefs. I did not hold them until I got to college. And for me, what a key trigger for me was reading the Bible. I was a literature major in college, and I never understood any of the biblical references in the stories that and the novels we were reading. And one day I decided I ought to read the Bible so I would at least understand my English classes. And I found, as I started reading, that it was entirely compelling, and it rang true for me in a way that nothing else had. So I wouldn't say I have strongly held another set of beliefs, although I toyed with one or two other competitors early on.
What about you, Eugene?
No, not really.
Eugene, have you ever been tempted by a...
Well, I'll tell you. When I was brought up by my parents, but also my grandparents. In Russia, there was very little living space. My parents lived with my grandparents. Come to America, more living space, but my grandparents were quite old at the time, didn't speak English, so lived with them. Very much loved them, both my grandmother and my grandfather. They were both getting on in years. Both had lived through a lot. And my grandfather, I remember, was in fact quite old, and he lived for quite a while after this happened, but I felt that you know, I began to see mortality. And I remember at one point, almost like a Pascal's wager, like what harm could it do, sort of praying for a span of a couple of weeks at night for my grandfather. Not very specifically just, well, it's all about my grandfather, but this was the one thing that I felt if I wanted to ask God for, if there was a God, I should ask. And I suppose I was just trying it on kind of, and it didn't fit. I guess I just felt like, what basis do I have for doing something that I really don't at all see any empirical foundation for? As to moral judgment, I actually recognize that a lot of a moral judgment doesn't have empirical foundation as such. But as to sort of making a claim even to myself that there is a God, I just didn't work for me. And then I sort of thought a little bit about Pascal's wager. I'm not sure if it was exactly then, but right around then I thought some about it. And I realized that, well, Pascal seemed to be working in an environment where it was essentially Christianity or nothing. By then, Protestantism was an option, but still, you could think of Christianity or nothing. And then you could say, well, it'll either do no harm or it'll do some good. But one could equally well say, or it'll do nothing, or it'll do some good, or it'll do some harm. What if I'm praying to the wrong God? What if he'll smite my grandfather just because of the presumption I have, or the real God, of my praying to a false God? I realized I have no basis for thinking that, but I had no basis for thinking the opposite. So since you asked, I didn't want to mention this because it was sort of what I did when I was 9 or 10. You know, what's that mean? But there was one time, and it didn't seem to work for me, and I haven't been really drawn to it since.
Okay. So why don't we take our first question from the audience? Is this the question here? No? Over here, then.
I wanted to address David, and you had mentioned two specific reasons for faith or belief or trust in the resurrection, and that was the women and also that the first Christians all died for, or many died for, that faith. I was wondering if you would add a third, and that third element might be something like the historical documents, the manuscripts of the New Testament, including the Chester Beatty Biblical Papyri, the abbreviation would be P45 from 100 AD, or the Codex Alexandrinus or Vaticanus, a complete New Testament from about 300 AD. Would this, from a legal perspective, because it shortens the distance time-wise between the resurrection and when we have written evidence, from a legal perspective, would that be a third basis for trust in the resurrection, or is the distance still too great?
So I'll put the legal perspective of it to one side, just to, I think, simplify my answer, and start out by saying, I am not an expert on the canon debate or the early documents, so you should take what I say with a little bit of a grain of salt. But I do believe that kind of evidence is additional evidence. So one of the arguments that people often make is that the Gospels, the four Gospel accounts of Jesus' life and teaching, were written well after his death, that they're thought to have been written in the late 90s, 80s and 90s AD. But when you look at the internal conversation within the New Testament, it actually ends up being much closer. Paul's letters are much closer in time to when Jesus actually died. Paul, the Apostle Paul, talks about 500 people being alive today who witnessed the resurrection. So when you put the documents together in that way, and when you put the documents together in the way that you're talking about, when did we have a complete New Testament or complete various pieces of the New Testament? It was not that late. I do think that's additional evidence. And another thing that I think that is remarkable about the documents of Christianity is that, unlike with many religions, they were not closely guarded. It was not a situation where people were not allowed to see and debate the documents. The debate about what went into the canon, what didn't go into the canon, what were legitimate documents, what weren't, this was completely public. And people were writing about this and giving speeches about it. So this was a completely open debate, which to me reinforces the credibility of the documents. It's not, nobody was hiding anything from anybody else. So my short answer to your question is, I think if we look into that kind of evidence, that's additional evidence. I think there's some other kinds of evidence for the resurrection as well. I was just using two examples because they're simple and I think they're quite powerful examples.
I guess I've mentioned this before, but just seems, I think, to be a useful guideline, is think about what you think when somebody claims that certain supernatural events occur. And I use supernatural broadly because it may be religious or it may be things that are not visibly religious, but still supernatural in the sense that they violate our understanding of the natural world. And this person, what kind of evidence would you expect with regard to that, especially when it's not reproducible, especially when the claim is about what happened some hundreds of years ago, but some supernatural event, some miracle, some supernatural creatures or what have you. And just ask yourself that and then apply it, I think, to all supernatural claims, equally whether they're a familiar religious tradition or not. And if you conclude that, in fact, the evidence for Christianity is way more powerful than the evidence that people for every century always bring up with regard to a wide variety of things that we do not believe, well, then, sure. I mean, that sounds like that's proof that is satisfactory to you. But if you sort of say, you know, it takes a lot to persuade me of, again, what is said by other religions or by people who believe in other supernatural things, and it takes more than what I see there, well, then I think that, too, points one in a particular direction.
All right. Our next question I'm going to take from a question that we've received via text, and this is for Eugene. If we are muddling through, how do we progress forward in justice? Do you think there is an absolute form of justice?
Well, I'm not sure if there's an absolute form of justice. It's possible. I'm open to the possibility that some future Kant or Rawls or Ayn Rand or somebody else can really demonstrate some structure, although even they, I take it, would have some humility about how many of the justice questions are answered directly by that. I feel it doesn't seem to have happened yet. So I think it's possible. I'm just not particularly confident about it. Now, how do we go forward? Well, let me just offer an example, and I think this is an interesting example, where I do think, while there are obviously Christians on one side, there are also Christians on the other, and that is women's rights, that we have changed. We in America and in most of the Western world have changed from an environment where a couple of hundred years ago it was thought that it was just wrong for women to be professionals. Not because women were evil necessarily or inferior in some aggregate sense, but because they just weren't very good at certain things. And that was just their nature, and often there were claims from various religious traditions that were introduced, as they continue to be in some measure introduced today. I do think we've progressed some, and I think we've progressed in several ways. One is I do think technology has helped a lot. I think the fact that women can choose when to bear their children, forgetting about the abortion debate, but just through contraception, I think that has changed a lot. I think economics has changed too, that the fact that a lot fewer people have to work in the fields using their physical strength diminished the various advantages that men ended up having in the workforce because men are biologically stronger, generally speaking. But on top of that, I think also people were thinking about things like equality. Like, well, yes, in fact, sometimes we thought about it from a religious perspective, sometimes otherwise. You know, why shouldn't women have the same opportunities for both economic reward and personal reward that comes from professional life, let's say, if they so choose. I think that people also started thinking more scientifically. Say, well, it's interesting that people say that women just aren't as good at certain things as men are. It's true, they aren't at certain things, physical. There might be biological differences in cognition, but if you really look at things, turns out that women can be just as good lawyers as men, just as good doctors, and so on and so forth.
Elizabeth is happy to hear that.
There you go. So I think it's a combination. I think economic and technical conditions improved, and I do think they're going to be improving in some measure. I think people actually got some input from science. Science can't answer moral questions, but it can provide some input. And I think people, again, sort of started thinking somewhat more empathetically, somewhat more with an eye towards why shouldn't everybody have certain kinds of things that one sex has long taken for granted, or at least the relatively prosperous among that sex. So I think things seem to have improved. And in that respect, I think it's hard to make the case that they improved largely because of Christianity. And I think it was an example of kind of secular advance in moral thinking, which I'm hoping can be duplicated in other ways.
Thank you.
So I'll just add one thing to that. And I mostly agree with you, as often is the case. One thing I'll say is in the early Christian period, Christianity was revolutionary in its treatment of women's rights. So when Christianity said there is no male or female in Christ, you know, that there's no Jew or Gentile, we're all equal, that was seen as outrageous in the Roman Empire. In the Roman Empire, women were not, they were second-class citizens and then some. I believe that Christianity has played a role in equalization of women's rights to men's rights through time. But I also agree with Eugene that some of these other factors have played a huge role. And this is another one of those issues where in a perfect world, we would be where we are now and better 2,000 years ago rather than now. It's taken a long time, and some of the reasons why we've made progress in the last century, I think, are the kinds of things that Eugene has talked about. Birth control more recently, the less importance of physical work and more importance of mental work and other forms of work. A number of factors, I think, have played an important role, and I agree with you about that.
Why don't we take another question from the audience?
Yes, the last question kind of stole my question, so I'll modify it. if you did discover that there wasn't any, it's for Eugene, by the way. So you said it's possible that there isn't justice or there aren't objective moral duties. I wanted to know, what if you discovered that there weren't any objective moral duties and justice wasn't a real objective thing? How would that change your disposition with respect to the quest for justice? And I'm asking that because it seems that you're saying that it couldn't be there, but yet you kind of want it to be there. And what does that say about?
Well, I want it to be there because of my current predisposition towards it. So let's try to make it more concrete. Imagine that somebody could somehow prove, in a way that really y'all look and try very, very hard, and you just can't get around it. Somebody could prove that judgments about morality are just like judgments about aesthetics. That some people have it more than others, some people feel very strongly about it, but there's really no basis whatsoever. And it's a footnote, some people claim there is something of a basis, objective basis for aesthetics. Let's set that aside because I doubt it. there's really no basis whatsoever for believing that any view about morality is better than any other view. I should think that would affect people's judgments. I mean, I do think that may lead to a world that today we think is horrific, but by hypothesis, if it's proven that it's only horrific because that we only think it's horrific because we happen to think this way. We're conditioned to think this way, the way that somebody may have thought that abstract art is horrific, but now after some centuries, at least some people like it just fine. Then I would say, well, look, all right, this is what's been proven to be so. Likewise, I take it. I mean, David, you say you've reached this examination of the evidence. I take it that if somebody came up with really, really solid evidence that proved it was all false, some archaeological evidence in which just there came to be no doubt in your mind that this was all just made up as part of some sinister plot, I take it that you'd presumably change your views. Maybe not on specific moral questions, because that's a separate issue, but at least it's the theology. So I think if you hypothesize that I were persuaded that there's no objective justice, and it's just like aesthetics, well then by hypothesis would be a very different world we're living in. I'm hoping indeed that's not the world that we're living in, but yes, that's always possible.
So can I say two quick things? One is I agree with you about Christianity and evidence. In my view, Christianity rises or falls on the resurrection of Jesus. And if someone could show that Jesus was not resurrected from the dead, if there were a photograph of that, rather than the photograph of the resurrection, the resurrection photo would be cooler.
You'd need a video.
Yeah, I think you're right about that. If you could prove Jesus was not resurrected, Christianity falls, in my view. And just as if you could prove it was resurrected, Christianity rises. The other thing I'll say is I'm skeptical of anybody really not believing in some objective right and wrong and moral judgments. I mean, I feel like we all have at some level a sense that there are some questions on which there are objective moral right and wrong answers. And my suspicion is that folks often piggyback on Christianity in making those judgments. I'd be curious.
I think both of those last things you said are absolutely right. I do think that possibly the exception of certain people whom we view as basically sociopaths,
right,
that everybody thinks that there is objective right or wrong. If people are very relativistic, and then or they claim to be very relativistic,
right,
to the point where they say, well, no, it's all a matter of just society. Say, well, I happen to have a society down my block that likes to do this and that. Oh, no, they can't be allowed to do that because they're part of our society. Well, they think they're part of their society. No, because it's wrong. Why is it wrong? Because people do believe, I think, at some bottom. And I think in part, again, that's an evolved trait that throughout most of human evolution, and by the way, here I'm getting way outside my area of expertise, so this is just what I'd heard and seems reasonable to me. Perhaps evolutionary psychologists in the room can correct me on this, but it's hard to imagine that during most of what we understand to be human history, where people lived in very small bands of hunters and gatherers, that any band would survive unless there were very deeply felt emotional things that translate into things like you don't kill people, at least in certain situations when you do, and the like. And the last I think that's absolutely right.
All right, we have another email question, this time for David. Why do I need a religious worldview to be just if I can live a moral and just life without one?
In a way, I've talked a little bit about this issue before. Well, further, I'll say a couple things about it. One thing I'll say is, there's a tendency, particularly in our culture, for people to say all of those different religions have good points and bad points, but they're all partial to a particular culture or a particular place, and no one of them is true, and I don't need any one of those. I think it's important to keep in mind that this perspective or this position that I can cast judgment on all these other worldviews is itself a position that needs to be interrogated. There tends to be an assumption that we're objective, looking from the outside on all these different partial theories of reality. That supposedly objective position is itself a position, and it really is a Western kind of position, this idea that all religions are equivalent. But really, to get to the heart of the question, why do you need religion? I believe that you don't have a foundation for making distinctions between right and wrong or moral judgments otherwise. I think sometimes people piggyback on religious understandings of right and wrong, but without religion, and I would argue without Christianity, there's not a foundation. Or another way to put it is there's no ought. There's nothing that tells you how you ought to behave or nothing that creates an obligation. If you don't believe in any particular religion or any particular set of beliefs, there are things that might seem better or might seem worse. You might think that Rawls is pretty persuasive. You might think John Stuart Mill is pretty persuasive. But there's nothing that tells you that you ought to do this or ought to do that. And there's no necessary connection between what you think is moral and your beliefs about the world. And so in my view, religion is necessary. Christianity, in my view, is necessary to create that sense of obligation. Christianity does obligate us to pursue justice. It obligates us to pursue a particular kind of justice. A view that there is no objective truth is compatible with all kinds of different views. And as I said earlier, if Eugene were the one that were making the decisions, I'd be okay with that. If Stalin's the one that's making the decisions, I'm a lot less okay with it.
I just want to return to two things that I'd said, but I think speak directly to this question. One is, I do think that if you look at the historical record, Christianity has shown itself to be compatible with vast range of possible answers to questions on justice. Now, maybe truly perceived Christianity wouldn't be, but how do people tell whether it's truly perceived or not? My sense is it's, again, through the same process of kind of moral intuition and talking to other people and seeing how things feel to you that one is trying to evade by saying, I'm committed to Christianity, because it turns out the commitment to Christianity historically has not proven to be a commitment to any particular moral system. It's something beyond that. It's a decision to embrace a particular view of Calvinism, a particular view of Catholicism, as of a particular century in a particular place that tells you how it is you actually behave. But the second thing is, look, even if accepting some religious belief system would make me a more just person, and even though I would like to be a more just person, I can't see how I can accept as factually true claims that I think I do not have enough factual evidence for. So I'm not sure it's even a particularly helpful question to ask whether one can be just without being religious, or whether becoming religious would make one more just. Because to become religious, it seems to me, it requires an acceptance of certain factual claims. And, you know, that's not something, things aren't true just because we would like them to be true, or because we think we'd be a better person if they were true.
Can I do a tiny follow-up on
sure.
that? And I want to say something kind of provocative for Eugene, and that is, I would argue that there's a direct connection between Christianity and democracy, and the kind of Western democracy that we know emerged directly from Christianity and from an understanding of our role and our place in the political state. Does that strike
you? Mean Christianity or particular parts of Christianity? Certainly there have been facets of Christianity that have actually struggled quite hard against
right.
democracy.
So let me narrow it then. Reformed Protestant Christianity.
Certain kinds of reform.
Calvin and after.
So, you know, it's certainly possible. I think that Christianity is certainly very much correlated with certain particular things. It's actually very hard to tell for sure whether this is so, because there are other things that are also correlates. It turns out that democracy did indeed emerge in the modern world basically in one place.
Right.
And also the Industrial Revolution and the like. And exactly why this is so, maybe it's Christianity, maybe it's something else. I'm certainly open to the possibility that particular strains of Christian belief facilitated certain kinds of improvements in human condition. But there again, you'd have to ask, well, what is it about that led people to that? And it isn't just acceptance of Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior and the notion that he died on the cross and was resurrected, because lots of other Christians who didn't come to that and even fought against that actually shared that theological pre-commitment or commitment.
All right, why don't we take another question?
Oh, there it goes. I think we're good now. Thank you. Hi. I had one question that's maybe both of you can answer, but particularly directed towards Eugene. I guess you said that you were currently muddling through, and you had said maybe something along the lines of follow your own path. And if you think that path is right for you, then you should follow that path. Well,
That's a very high level of generality.
Okay,
there are many possible interpretations of that I would completely disagree with.
Okay. Can you maybe clarify what you said about if your religion, if that religion fits you, then you should follow that religion?
Well, no. If you find that there is sufficient factual evidence to believe in something that other people do not believe in, whether it's the germ theory of disease or the notion that the Earth and the planets revolve around the sun, although there at least have been some precedent before Copernicus for that, and but whether it's that or something that we consider today to be supernatural, if you really find yourself believing that, I might think you're wrong for believing that. All of us take that view with regard to certain beliefs that others have, whether they're religious beliefs or other beliefs, but if you believe that, you kind of have to go with that.
you kind of have to say, well, if I accept religion X, could be Christianity or something else, and I accept the claims of miracles at the heart of that, then, well, I have to see what that means for me in terms of my moral obligations. I'm not saying that all of them are equally sound by any means. I'm just saying that I recognize that once people accept something, rightly or wrongly, that's what they should be doing. And I can't very well at that point give this person advice, no. Even though you believe this to be true, you should completely ignore whether it's pulling you, because I think as a matter of their own integrity, they should, even if I think it's pulling them in the wrong direction.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so then, based on that description of what you think people should follow, what, say, one person believes in religion X, and another person believes in religion Y, and both of these people believe they should be acting in a certain way, and yet those actions contradict each other. Is there a certain moral absolute to which everyone should maybe follow? And then this is also directed towards Skeel as well. Are there moral absolutes, and do those moral absolutes fit in with justice? And then for both of you, where do you find your origin in justice?
Let me give an analogy, which is not by any means a perfect analogy. Mm-hmm. That's why it's an analogy. There is probably an absolute standard for how to live as long as possible, as healthy as possible, with as high a quality of life in the medical sense as possible. It may vary actually from person to person because of their environments and because of their genetic makeup, but there might be sort of a meta standard. And I'm actually very much hoping at some point scientists will figure it out and tell me before it's too late for me. At the same time, if somebody were to say, look, I have read all of this stuff and I come to believe that the paleo diet is the right way of doing things, then I'd say, well, it sounds like you probably should be eating that way. And if I then see him eating lots of bread, which I've told the paleo people aren't supposed to eat, I will actually think maybe he's just fine health-wise, but he's actually doesn't seem to be a very strong-willed person. Because on the one hand, he claims that all this evidence has led him to this conclusion. On the other hand, he's taking his life into his hands by eating all this bread. An exaggeration, but something along those lines. So I would like to think that there is a moral belief system that is absolute out there. And I'm certainly willing to throw people in prison for violating what I think is at least a reasonable approximation of that. At the same time, I have to acknowledge that if somebody says, well, I believe in religion X, and somebody else says, believe in religion Y, my telling them, no, there's a morally absolute standard, it's religion Z or no religion at all, is going to somehow persuade them. I mean, there's just limitations to what my assertions of what is morally absolute right are going to do to people who have completely different view of either the facts or the moral judgments.
So I don't completely agree with that. I'll just say a couple things. I do think that there are moral absolutes, and it matters what they are, that religion X and religion Y are not the same thing. I think that often there are ranges of overlap where we can agree, but I believe it ultimately makes a huge difference.
Of course.
Let me give one example. A good example, it seems to me, is human rights. Human rights are popular now across a wide spectrum of views, but what human rights means is different from different perspectives. So what human rights means for a Christian is that we are all made in the image of God, and that human rights apply equally to all of us, no matter whether we're male or female, whether we're young or old, whether we're weak or strong. The emerging view of human rights among many secular intellectuals, and to give an exaggerated example, Peter Singer, an ethicist at Princeton, has articulated this quite explicitly, is that the basis for our human rights is our consciousness and our ability to plan out our lives. That's what makes us, what gives us dignity, and what makes us worthy of respect. That turns out to be a very different vision of human rights than a Christian vision of human rights. One difference is that if you believe consciousness is the basis for human dignity, you will believe people who are intellectually disabled, mentally disabled, are different from people who aren't. You will believe that babies are different from people who are fully mature. And in my view, it makes a huge difference for what your vision of human rights is. And so I do think the differences matter. I do think that there are ranges of overlap. I mean, I think that there are many issues on which people now with very different views, and human rights is often one of them, can agree on what the general right answer is. But it's also the case that that agreement doesn't go all the way down. And in my view, the differences matter, and they matter very, very deeply.
Sounds right to me.
So thank you all for your questions. We're unfortunately at the end of our time. And so I'd like to close by asking each of Eugene and David just to share with us, if you had one challenge for those of us who are here tonight, what would it be as we leave?
A challenge? What do you mean by a challenge? I mean, what do you mean, a challenge?
I think a challenge in the sense of, you're really asking me what I mean. I think in the sense of, you know, we've been talking about justice. If you had one thing you'd like to exhort the students to think about or to do or to consider as they continue to ponder the questions we've been discussing tonight, what would it be?
Well, so I'm not sure this is right, but I do want to suggest, it complementarily to what I'd said earlier, although in some respects different, but I think it's complementary, that while it's important for us to think a lot about justice and a lot about making our our actions more just, making sure we do not act unjustly ourselves, I think we should also not forget in our right focus, even obsession with justice, that there are a lot of things that improve the world and probably improve justice too, that a lot of institutions, a lot of inventions, a lot of structures that are really good to have, and if you're and that it's a very worthwhile thing to think about what they are and how they can be improved. So to take one example, democracy has a couple of different components to it that are related to justice. One is, you might say, democracy is itself more just because it treats people equally, because it says not, in the words of someone I forget, but I forget who it was, but at least I remember his words, that that humans were made either as horses to be ridden on or as riders to ride them. That it's not that humans were divided into these two groups, the common and the aristocrats, but that we're all equal. And if we're all equal, why shouldn't we have the same vote? Why should anybody else have power over us that is greater than the power that each of us has over everybody? So that's one justification of democracy. Another justification for democracy is that it actually produces a world in which at least certain kinds of unjust behaviors become harder. That there are particular kinds of unjust behaviors, not the only kinds, but there are certain very common ones that democracy is pretty good at fighting. I think another example is the free market. I think generally speaking, the free market tends to also help promote both justice and independently also human happiness, which is something that's worth considering as well. Not entirely, but in many ways. I think another example is technological progress, that unbalanced technological progress, I think, has in some measure improved justice. Maybe I'm wrong on one or another of these, but the challenge is to think, what are, if you either, I mean, you may want to devote your life to justice, but if you're not going to devote your life to justice, what other things are there out there that might be justice promoting, even though we don't think of them as fundamentally justice issues? And maybe, given the radical disagreement among us on many justice issues, maybe we can bridge that disagreement in some measure by helping promote those institutions that will allow an increase in justice, even though, by the standards of virtually all of us, even though there are disagreements among us that remain about what justice really is.
A great answer, and I think I completely agree with that answer. I'll add a couple thoughts of my own. One is to say again that, and really to say what Eugene said more elegantly, although you disclaimed that the point about thinking hard about justice, and then you went on to think hard about justice and explain that we ought to reconceptualize a little bit how we think about justice. I would go back to Eugene's original claim and say my challenge would be to think hard about justice and what you understand justice to be and why you feel compelled to contribute to justice, if you do feel compelled to contribute to justice. From a Christian perspective, I would repeat two themes that I've mentioned a number of times. One is, I believe that from a Christian perspective, it's important to be humble about justice and about the capacity in particular of law, which is really consistent with some of the things Eugene was just saying. We in America tend to love the law too much, in my view, and to think the law can do too much. And I think Christianity provides a way of thinking about that and an explanation of that, that we have a tendency to be sinful and to be overly optimistic about ourselves. So one thing I would say is Christian perspective instructs us to be humble about the law. But the other thing, which points in the opposite direction, that I would say again is, as a Christian, I believe that I've been reconciled with God through Christ, and I believe that what that means is that the world will ultimately be put to rights. I'm not optimistic about our capacity to achieve justice, but I am optimistic about God's capacity to achieve justice. And one of the really cool things about that perspective is that means I believe the little things I do, including the little things Eugene was talking about, have eternal significance. They're not just one-off, but if they are improving the justice of the world, they may matter for all eternity. And I think that's an exciting prospect.
Well, thank you both so much. I wish we could continue this much longer.
For more information about the Veritas Forum, including additional recordings and a calendar of upcoming events, please visit our website at veritas.org.